So welcome everybody to the second part of my lecture in this course on coordinate systems. Today I will talk about how we would refer the motion of a satellite, the position of a satellite with respect to an Earth-fixed coordinate system, and eventually how we draw these maps of the ground track of a satellite that you all know and that can be used, for instance, for planning a satellite mission or for planning visibility and for many interesting applications. So my name is Jürgen Kusche, and I will now first introduce a new system, which is the inertial coordinate system. And we need the inertial coordinate system since satellite motion always can be much better described with respect to an inertial system. I mean, satellite motion, the orbit of a satellite, the orbital plane of a satellite, as you know, satellites typically fly in elliptical orbits, and these orbits and the orbital planes are always almost constant with respect to inertial space. But from the Earth, which is rotating underneath a satellite orbit, the orbital motion looks very complicated. So we will always need to introduce the inertial coordinate system as a sort of intermediate system here. So the inertial system is required. Of course, it's required for precise computations like satellite orbit computations, for geodetic data analysis. It's also required for Earth rotation measurements, of course. You need to know orbit, the Earth rotation also for interplanetary trajectory planning. Practically, the inertial reference system is realized for the so-called International Celestial Reference Frame. This is a reference frame, it's a coordinate system that is realized, that we have access to, for the positions of the fixed stars, in fact, for the position of the radio stars, to which we can measure with radio telescopes. So the positions of these radio stars give us access to this inertial reference frame. Or what about the terrestrial reference frame? The terrestrial reference frame, where we have defined this ellipsoid of revolution in fact, the terrestrial reference system, this is a system where all the terrestrial markers, the permanent positions, the permanent GPS stations, all the space geodetic instruments are located. A marker is a location on the surface of the Earth, which we can access with a geodetic instrument. So it's accessible, so we can realize our position in this coordinate system. We can simply occupy a position. So the terrestrial reference frame is realized for all these geodetic markers. It's the system where the ellipsoid of revolution is defined within. The terrestrial reference frame is this frame. Okay? The practical realization is the International Terrestrial Reference Frame. Now, of course, we need to describe the rotation of the ITRF with respect to the ICRF. This is the Earth rotation matrix. And we will hear about that also a lot in our lectures. So in fact, the orientation of the ITRF in inertial space needs to be described through a sequence of rotations. The true orientation of the Earth-fixed system, in fact, I do not make a distinction between a reference system and a reference frame here. The orientation of the Earth-fixed system with respect to space is rather complicated. But here in this lecture, we will not follow these complicated motions. We will simply assume that the rotation between the inertial and the terrestrial system as a function of time can be described through one single angle. And this is the so-called Earth rotation angle, and it's a simple rotation about the z-axis. So all we need to know is the constant rotation rate of the Earth, which is 2 pi per sidereal day, times time, times delta t, so time with respect to a reference epoch. So actually this is this. So we need to know the Earth rotation angle at, let's say, at time zero, which can be at midnight. Okay? And of course we need the rotation rate of the Earth. This is a very simplistic view. It's okay for, keep in mind, planning purposes, but it's not okay for centimeter or millimeter precise positioning. Professor Schindelegger in his lecture will later talk about how we represent the rotation matrix of the Earth in more detail with many more complicated rotations, with a sequence of individual rotation matrices which have a physical interpretation, but here in this lecture we will not do this. We will not do this, we will not look at this complicated rotation, we will look at a simple rotation. We will assume that the inertial reference frame, which in this case is the red coordinate system, and the terrestrial reference frame, which in this case is the green coordinate system, we will assume there's just a rotation about the z-axis. The Earth rotates about the z-axis. Okay, it's pretty simplistic, but for short times we can probably apply this approximation. So the next step is we need to introduce Kepler angles in order to describe the orientation of the orbital plane of a satellite. So keep in mind, Kepler's laws state the orbital plane of a planet would remain fixed in inertial space, assuming that the planet orbits a central body. Central body means a central gravitational field, means in this case the gravitational field of the Sun can be approximated by the field of a perfect sphere. So seen from the body, the Sun is big, but it can be approximated by a sphere, which is probably a very good approximation. So Kepler's laws are not valid whenever the gravity field is a complicated gravity field, but it's valid for two bodies, point masses, that orbit around each other. And it's, of course, the same is true also for the orbit of a satellite with respect to a planet, like in this case, the Earth. Kepler also, well, Kepler's laws state that these orbits will be ellipses, Kepler ellipses. Again, that's not perfectly true whenever the gravitational field is more complicated, as in case for the Earth. But we come back to this later. Now, this also means that being able to measure the orbit of the satellite from the ground means that we have access to an inertial coordinate system. And this is probably much easier than measuring to the fixed stars or to the radio stars, since each GPS receiver, its GPS antenna and receiver, allows us measurements with respect to the two satellites. And assuming that the orbits of the GPS satellites would realize an inertial frame, so orbital plane would be fixed in inertial space, this gives us a possibility to measure, for instance, Earth rotation. Well, more about that in later lectures. So we need to talk a little bit about the geometry of the satellite ellipse. And it's in many, well, what we do here can be compared to what we did last lecture. Last lecture we looked at the Earth ellipse, a meridional ellipse. Here we look at the orbit of a satellite. There are some similarities, but there are also differences. We also use the semi-major axis, And we use the eccentricity or the flattening in order to describe the geometrical shape of the ellipse. What's different is we use the perigee and we use the apogee, and of course we use the focal point much more often, since in Kepler's theory the central body is in the focal point. So the Earth is here, it's not here. So do not forget this, the Earth is here, the Earth, the central point, the central body is here in the focal point. It also means that, for instance, if you're interested in the radius vector or the distance from the satellite, we are not interested in this radius, we're interested in this radius, which differs from the radius that I've shown you last time. What we also often need is a description of the position of the satellite within its orbital plane, which we get from this angle, which is called the true anomaly. It's the angle between the perigee and the position of the satellite, and it's this anomaly moves between 0 and 360 degrees within one revolution time of the satellite. So 100, let's assume the revolution time is 100 minutes, then this angle, this true anomaly, will proceed from 0 to 360 degrees within 100 minutes. But not in a perfectly uniform way. And it's obvious why, since if the satellite is close to the perigee, it's moving much faster, as you may know from Kepler's laws. Okay. Now let's assume we have the Kepler elements, given the Kepler elements, the capital omega, which is also called the right ascension of the ascending node, and I will come back to that in a moment. The I, which is the inclination of the orbit, and the small omega, which gives the position of the satellite's perigee. We will be able to build a rotation matrix from the, and this is important, inertial reference system to a satellite orbital reference system. An orbital a reference system, a coordinate system, that describes better the position of a satellite with respect to the orbital plane, as you will see. Now, how could this look like? Now, this figure, maybe you've seen this figure before, this gives a geometrical interpretation of the Kepler orbital elements. So we have the, well, let's begin here, this is the orbital plane. And this is the so-called nodal line. The nodal line is the crossing line, so where the orbital plane crosses the XY plane of the inertial reference system. It's also called the celestial equator. And this is the orbital plane. It's the nodal line. We have two crossings. Of course, on the other side, there's also another crossing. And this is called the ascending node, when the satellite moves from the southern hemisphere to the northern hemisphere, and on the other side, when the satellite moves from the northern hemisphere to the southern hemisphere, it would be called the descending node. And there's an angle, of course, of 180 degrees between these nodal orientations. And the capital omega describes the orientation of the nodal line with respect to the inertial x-axis. And keep in mind, Kepler postulated, or Newton later postulated, this would be constant. So the nodal line, and this means the orientation of the orbital plane, would be constant in space. As I mentioned already, it's not true. Whenever the central body is flattened, like the Earth, then we have a precession of the orbital plane. Knowing omega allows us also to compute a rotation matrix. This is the first step of the rotation going from the inertial system, from the red arrows here, to the orbital reference frame. So it's a rotation about the z-axis, about the angle capital omega, the right ascension. Right ascension is angle, any angle computed with respect to the inertial x-axis. So it's the right ascension of the ascending, this must be D, ascending node of the satellite. And you will find the abbreviation RAAN also for the angle capital omega. Okay, now after this rotation about the z-axis, we have a new intermediate coordinate system with these x and y-axis. The next step is now to move the z-axis in this direction, which is perpendicular on the orbital plane. And we have to rotate now about the x-axis with the angle I. I is the inclination of the orbital plane with respect to the celestial equator. Okay? And this can be zero if it's a so-called equatorial orbit, and it can be 90 degrees for a polar orbit. So this can be any angle. And this angle, of course, pops up here again between these two z-axes. Actually, the direction perpendicular on the orbital plane can also be related to physics. This is the direction of the angular momentum of the orbital plane h. So the unit vector u3 is the normalized angular momentum. We will not look at the physics here. So this is another simple rotation about, in this case, the x-axis, about the inclination angle. So after that, we are here. And after that, well, before we move to the satellite position, we will move to the position of the perigee. And the position of the perigee in the orbital plane is characterized by small omega, the angle of the perigee with respect to the nodal line. So it's here. And why do we move to the perigee? The position of the perigee gives us the orientation of the satellite ellipse within the orbital plane. So we need to know this in order to be able to compute the exact satellite position. And in order to go to the exact satellite position later, well, we need to know this angle here to move from the perigee to the satellite position. This is the true anomaly, and I've introduced this before, can be computed. We, of course, also we need this distance. It's a distance from the focal point. So it's the R. It's the R which can be computed from the geometry of the ellipse. Okay, but back to this step. We will apply small omega, and this is another rotation about the z-axis, but of course it's the new z-axis now in this position. So after this, we have an orbital reference frame, an orbital coordinate system with the x-axis, unit vector u1, pointing towards the perigee, the y-axis perpendicular, the z-axis perpendicular on the orbital plane. This is the reference system or reference frame, which we typically use then to describe the position of the satellite, or maybe also the position of other satellites with respect to this satellite. For instance, if you're planning maneuvers or rendezvous maneuvers between two satellites. Okay, now doing the math means we end up with this complicated rotation matrix. And this can also be computed whenever these Kepler elements, these angles, are in fact time dependent. Okay? So this is true not only if the angles are time constant. This is always true. But this is a very useful expression. Okay. Now I mentioned already several times, due to the flattening of the Earth, the omega is not constant. Omega is changing with time. And from the dynamics, we have this relation. I will not derive this here. We will discuss this in other lectures. But this says the rate of change of capital omega depends on the so-called dynamic flattening of the Earth and the inclination. So for different inclination, we have a different rate of change. But of course, it depends on the so-called dynamic flattening. The dynamic flattening differs from the geometric flattening, which you know already. C minus E, A is the difference in the main moments of inertia of the Earth. That's the reason why it's called dynamic flattening. If the Earth would be a perfect sphere, all the moments of inertia would be the same, then this difference would be zero, obviously. Okay. This, keep in mind, can be 1 or maybe 2 or maybe 3 degree per day. Okay, so a full revolution after 1 year is a perfectly reasonable number. It's just to give you an order of magnitude. Obviously, it can also be zero. Yeah? If the cosine is zero, okay, or which inclination is this the case? Well, an easy question for the exam. However, we are interested in describing the orientation of the orbital plane with respect to the rotating Earth, since in the end we want to draw a map. So we have to add the Earth rotation. Okay? The Earth is rotating underneath the satellite orbit. Satellite is rotating, is moving in its orbit, but also the orbital plane is rotating with respect to inertial space. Okay? So seen from the Earth, we have the of course we have the Earth rotation, the omega here, this is the Earth's rotation rate, 2 pi per day. So this differs from, this is not the omega that we used for describing the perigee, okay? This is the rotation rate of the Earth. And this is the rate with which the orbital plane of the satellite moves with respect to inertial space. Okay, so in sum, this is the rotation rate between the orbital plane of the satellite and the fixed Earth. Okay, so let's move to ground track computations, which, as I mentioned before, are approximate transformations. In fact, from Keplerian orbit to the geographical coordinates of the sub-satellite point. So, of course, what we need is Kepler elements for a satellite, or there's another variant of Kepler elements which is called two-line elements. This is basically it's the same, let's say. These elements can be obtained on the internet for virtually any satellite in space. Yeah, so there are databases where everybody can download in real time these positions for every satellite in space, of course, except the spy satellites and maybe some very recently launched satellites, but for almost all the satellites you can obtain these in real time, not at very high precision. You can also obtain this for the space station and for lots of space debris. Yeah, so this is monitored and everybody has access to this, typically in the form of T-line elements. This also gives you the change of the Kepler elements with time. So you get a relatively precise, well, you get a description of the satellite orbit, which is precise maybe at the kilometer level. So what I'm doing in the following is not accurate at the centimeter level, but it doesn't need to be. It's not intended for positioning purposes. It's meant, for instance, for planning purposes. So we want to be able to draw a ground track map of a particular satellite. We also want, for instance, we want to be able to know when would the satellite move over a certain ground antenna. Maybe you want to compute a visibility schedule for a certain antenna. Maybe also you want to design the orbit of a satellite to have a nice pattern over the Mediterranean here. Maybe you want to avoid these points where the satellite orbits converge. Maybe you want to fill these spaces in between. Okay, so what you need is a planning tool for this. And this is what we will talk about. So we will, for the moment, but only for deriving simple equations, we will assume the satellite orbit is circular. We will assume for the moment the orbital plane is constant Kepler parameters. And we will also, of course, assume that the true anomaly of the satellite, which is the angle of the satellite position with respect to the perigee, that this moves uniform, which is the same as to saying the true anomaly is the mean anomaly. The satellite moves in its position uniformly. In my example, with the 100 minutes revolution time, it moves uniformly within these 100 minutes. So it's very easy to compute the satellite position in its orbital ellipse. So we need a little bit of spherical trigonometry now. So what I want to do is, I want to derive a way of going from the Kepler elements, like the small omega that I mentioned before, to the latitude and to the longitude of the satellite. So we will have a look at this spherical triangle, and this is actually the projection of the satellite position on, let's say, on a sphere. So this is a spherical triangle. Here's the satellite. Here's the projection point. Here's the equator. This would be the latitude, okay? Or actually, it's the spherical latitude. This is an angle of 90 degrees. This would be the longitude, but it's the longitude of the satellite with respect to the orbital node. And this is actually the position of the perigee plus the position of the satellite with respect to the perigee. So we need to know small omega and we need to know the anomaly. Small omega is constant, or maybe it's changing only slowly. And this is changing, as I mentioned within in my example, 100 minutes is changing by 360 degrees. So this is changing much faster than this. But we can assume that we know the two of them. We also know the inclination of the satellite. And then we do some spherical trigonometry, which tells us that this relation here equals to this relation. And since the sine of 90 degrees is 1, we can solve this actually for the sine of the spherical latitude of the satellite, which I've done here, which means the spherical latitude of the satellite is a sort of a projection of omega plus mu, which is the angle of the satellite with respect to the nodal line. We project this and we compute this here. And of course, we need the inclination of the orbital plane for this. And in a very similar way, we also can get lambda, which is here. So we have already the phi, we have already the latitude. In this triangle, we can also compute this side. And this is the lambda. We can get this from this relation here. So the lambda here, as I mentioned, computed with respect to the nodal line, is the arcus tangens of this expression. And at this moment, we know already the phi. So we know everything on the right-hand side. But as I mentioned, this is only with respect to the node line, so we need to compute, we need to add the omega to obtain the longitude with respect to the inertial system. So we are not arrived at a terrestrial system, but we're almost there. So to obtain the longitude with respect to Greenwich, the longitude with respect to the terrestrial x-axis, we need to add only the rotation of the Earth, the angle due to the rotation of the Earth. Now we have these three parts here. This is from the satellite position. This is from the position of the orbital plane in the inertial space. And as I mentioned, this can be time variable. So this would, if we have a precession of the orbital plane, this is time variable. Then we have this part from the rotation rate of the Earth. And this gives us the longitude with respect to the terrestrial z-axis, which is actually the Greenwich meridian. So this gives us the longitude which we would draw in a map. And with the latitude with respect to the equatorial plane, which is the same equatorial plane in the terrestrial system, we can also draw the longitude. Of course, this is the spherical longitude. In a map, we would be probably compute the geographical or ellipsoidal longitude, which is just another transformation. So for any time, we can compute the position of the satellite in a map. And this is what I wanted to show here. So wrapping these two lectures up. At this point, you should be able to explain the concept of the ellipsoidal reference surface, which is an ellipsoid of revolution. It's not written here, but you should also introduce, be able to introduce the ellipsoid, the G-weight as a physical reference surface. Then you should be able to implement the transformations from ellipsoidal to Cartesian coordinates, but also from Cartesian to ellipsoidal, which is a little bit more difficult. You remember, you need to apply iterations. Then you should be able to explain the concept of the orbital reference frame, and you should also be you should be able to implement simple mappings from the orbital coordinates to Earth-X coordinates, which means you should be able to draw the position of a satellite in basically in an Earth-X system in a map. As I mentioned several times, this transformation is valid at the level of a couple of hundred meters. A more detailed treatment needs to take into account Earth rotation. I mentioned that before, but also the issue of the realization of the reference frame in much more detail. So how exactly is the ITRF determined with respect and defined with respect to the Earth's crust? There will be more lectures about that. How is the ICRF exactly defined? Okay. It will also need to take into account the many variations of Earth rotations, but also the many perturbations of satellite orbits. Okay, but not here. There are lots of other lectures. There will be a homework assignment, and it's meant to cover a cross-section from what I explained last time and from this lecture. And you're asked to hand it in within 2 weeks. It will be provided via email or via eCampus or via a website. And your solution must include a written report, and it should be typeset, not handwritten. It should show some command of the technical language. It should provide a step-by-step explanation of the way of solving. You should write down explicitly the equations that you used. You should show all the intermediate results. You should provide all the results, of course correct, but also using the correct units. All the results must be provided with the relevant number of digits. That's very important, okay? All the codes that you used, and if you use figures or drawings, if you need them, feel free. So that's it from my side. I wish you fun with the homework assignment.